and worship you for me. This is my worship. All of my worship.
All of my worship.
This is my worship.
This is my worship.
All of my worship.
All of my worship.
Receive my worship.
This is my worship.
Receive my worship.
All of my worship.
Father, receive my worship.
This is my worship.
Doubt you were greatly blessed and enriched by last week's teaching. Today promises to be another mind-blowing moment. The theme remains post-COVID-19, life and sustainability. Let's make welcome our facilitator for today in person of Mr. Seun Olatoye.
So make yourself indispensable. You know, you might need, if you are looking for a job, the jobs available might be contract job. Be willing to take those roles. You know, and stay relevant. Be open to new ideas. You want to take up a job, it might involve relocation. Be flexible, be willing. You know, I've talked about remote jobs, they're going to become more and more prevalent. So we need to be ready for that. We need to prepare ourselves for that. You might want to start a business. I really believe that post-COVID-19, a lot of new things, a lot of great things will start. There will be a lot of startups. I just believe there will be a lot of startups, there will be a lot of great things to start. You know, so you need to trust God. I am also trusting God right now. One thing I'm trusting God for is divine idea, divine insight, divine inspiration. You know, God might give you an idea to start something. Post-COVID-19, we need to be open, we need to be sensitive. You know, we must be ready to take action. Be willing to explore new territory. Prepare for leadership. Organization will be looking for people with leadership skills who can motivate people, who can, you know, energize and galvanize people to be able to accomplish our goals, to be productive. You know, so train yourself to be a leader. Prepare for leadership, you know, learn about leadership. Be willing to do more. Be willing to give more. It's not going to be business as usual post-COVID-19. It's going to be business as usual. Network. You know, network with other people. Improve your profile. You know, that, like I said, you're looking for a job, or even whether you're a professional, you're not looking, you're in job, create a profile on LinkedIn. It's free. Go on LinkedIn at the minimum. Create a profile. And as you acquire new skills, new certification, new qualification, and enhance your profile. Make yourself marketable. Make yourself sellable. Market yourself. Sell yourself. Advertise yourself. And if you are going to be doing interview, prepare for interview. Get ready. You know, be adaptable, be flexible, acquire technology skills. There are some collaboration and productivity tools that will become more popular post-COVID-19. Right now, so many Microsoft tools are becoming more popular for collaboration and productivity. So many organizations will begin to consider all this, begin to embrace it. Cloud computing, a lot of people are moving their computing to the cloud. Microsoft Teams, OneDrive, you know, all these collaboration and productivity tools might become more and more popular. Educate yourself, learn about them. There's so many online platforms that are free for learning. You can easily learn about all these things that add value to yourself. That reminds me of the story of many years ago. In fact, specifically 2001, someone who studied agri engineering in school. He studied agri engineering and he saw an advert, you know, put out by an oil company, which says, apply for this position if you have a degree. If you have a degree in engineering, you can apply for this position. And then he applied. Remember, I studied agri engineering, but he's somebody that believes. He told me that he believes every year you should be adding value to yourself. So along the line, while he was, you know, doing a particular job, you know, working in a particular place, he was adding value to himself. He studied GIS, Geographic Information Science, or study. So he studied that, you know, like it's like a certification, and he got it, he kept it. And then when he saw this oil company advert, he applied, say degree in engineering, he applied. Although he had a degree in agri engineering, he applied, he went through the process. During the interview, the person interviewing him saw that in addition to what he studied in school, he has a certification in GIS. Said, that's interesting. Tell me about it. And tell me, how do you think this GIS knowledge will be useful in the oil company? And he went ahead and told him. Long story short, he got the job. This is the same job he applied for, along with graduates in petroleum engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, industrial engineering, and so on and so forth, chemical engineering. He studied agri engineering and got the job. Bottom line, or lesson, add value to yourself. We need to be adding value to ourselves continuously. Still talking about digital transformation, you know, artificial intelligence, machine learning, robotics, you know, big data, all these will be more and more popular post COVID-19. How about creativity and innovation? Creativity and innovation. Employers should be looking for workers who are creative. Employers will be looking for workers who are innovative. So creativity and innovation is going to be big, it's going to be huge and significant in helping us to sustain our job. To be indispensable, you need to be creative, you need to be innovative. I was watching a young man, you know, on the television, you know, who started making hand washing, you know, sink, you know, from scrap materials like drum, like tire, you put some plumbing material, and he was selling them to companies. You know, some people now are making contactless hand sanitizer locally. You know, some people are coming up with innovation, producing ventilators locally. So it's very important to be creative and innovative, repurpose and reinvent yourself. Be data literate. I can't say that enough. Digital skills, coding skills, leadership skills, you know, become committed to a lifetime of learning. Become committed to a lifetime of learning. Okay. Some of the qualities that recruiters will be looking for those that will be, you know, seeking job, be ambitious, be curious, be humble, have learning agility, be agile in learning, learn agile way of doing things, you know, positivity, reliability, and so on and so forth. And maybe you might consider even being a recruiter, you know, you might become a job recruiter. But you need to learn the skills. You need to get relevant knowledge, relevant information, if that is something you are considering. Now, you say, well, you'll be talking about those who have jobs, those who have employment and all that. What about the self-employed? What about the artisans? What about the traders? All we have been talking about is still applicable to the people who are self-employed, those who are traders, those who are artisans. You still need to retrain yourself, retool, repackage, retrain, learn better ways of doing what you are doing. Learn better ways. Don't just continue to do it the way you have been doing it 20, 30, 15 years ago. Learn better ways. Research new ideas. Look at magazines. You are a furniture maker. Look at what kind of furniture is now relevant. You need to look at that. You need to, you know, repackage also. repackaging. Some people make good products, but the packaging is not good. A product is as good as its package. So repackaging is very important. Repackage yourself, repackage your product, repackage your services. You know, research what the customer wants. Somebody said, put yourself in the position of the customer. Be like the customer. And ask yourself, if I'm the customer and I'm being treated like this by this person, will I come back? So treat the customer right. Focus on customer satisfaction. You know, in this part of the world, people don't do a lot of surveys or believe in surveys. Do survey and take the responses from the survey seriously. Treat your customer right so that they'll keep coming back. Repackage. You know, packaging is important. Add value to what you are doing. Add value to what you are doing, whether product or services. Don't just be faithful, be also good. You know, in the story of the parable of the talent, Jesus said when the master returned and he was asking all the servants to come and give account, those that made profit said, well done, thou good and faithful servant. The servant was not just faithful, but also good. It's not enough to be faithful, you have to be good also. Be good and faithful. And also, trader, artisans, look, you need to leverage technology. We need to leverage technology. I drove into the filling station to fill my car with petrol, and I asked the attendant, please, can I use, do you have POS? He said, yes, we have POS. Oh, really? Okay, go ahead. Don't want to be carrying a lot of cash. He filled the vehicle with the petrol. He looked at how much it is. I gave him the card. He put it in the POS, put the amount, that's it. Consider mobile payment. Cashless or cashless, leverage technology. Nothing says you can't get POS. There are some of the people that want to patronize you that they don't want to carry cash. If you have POS, it makes life easier for them, and that can attract customers to you. So very important, you know, we need to leverage technology, repackage, retool, and make your add value to the product or services that you are producing. And if you are considering transitioning from being an employee to a business owner, like I said, you know, so many ideas we spring up with COVID-19. So some people might be considering moving from being an employee to a business owner. Do your research. Know your best fit. What are you best fitted to do? Think about what is the need. There are so many needs that will, you know, surface post COVID-19. And those needs have to be met. How do people make money? People make money when they find a problem or a need and they meet that need or they solve that problem. In return, people will put money in their pocket. And time will not permit us to talk about examples and examples of people who have identified a need and met that need or solved a problem. And the result, they became millionaires or billionaires. So think about needs. Some needs will come. God will give us insight and idea to see some needs that will come up, that will crop up, that will surface post COVID-19. You know, write a business plan, engage a professional, register your business, do everything legally, and try as much as well to standardize, track your business, do things digitally, you know, as much as possible. Don't quit your job until you are ready. Until you are ready to launch out. So when you are ready, then you can then transit. Now, still talking about sustainability, as we gradually, you know, move towards the end, how can we respond to challenges? Without doubt, we have talked about all the challenges that COVID-19, the coronavirus pandemic, has thrown at our world. Challenges will always come in different form or shape, in diverse manner, but how do we respond to challenges? You know, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4:17, Paul the apostle writing to the Corinthian Christians, that our light affliction is just for a moment, but it's working for us a far and more exceeding an eternal weight of glory. He called it light affliction. It's just light affliction. He said it's for a moment. This challenge is for a moment. We're going to overcome it, we're going to surmount it. But what do we need to know in overcoming or responding to challenges? Three things, you know, according to Dr. B.C. Tofade, you know, he said there are three ways to respond to challenges. You can endure them, you can escape them, or you can enlist your challenges. Now, the Bible, you know, make that clear to us in 1 Samuel chapter 17. Popular story, David and Goliath. You know, Goliath came out, he was terrorizing, you know, and harassing the people of God. Soldiers, trained soldiers, he was terrorizing them. And they were enduring him day in, day out. He will come out, harass them, come out and challenge me. Nobody will go back. it was harassing them and they were enduring it. So some people can choose to endure challenges. Some people can choose to escape. See, talking about the David and Goliath story, the army of Israel, they were trying to escape. Once Goliath showed up, they will hide. They will run. They will go and hide. And this continued to happen day in, day out. They were trying to escape their challenges. And lastly, you can choose to enlist your challenges. Use it as a springboard to launch you into greater heights. You can let God use the challenges we are facing as springboards to launch us into something greater, something higher, something better. And that was exactly what David did. While other people, the other soldiers of Israel, were running away from Goliath, David was running towards Goliath with the sling in his hand and with God backing him. He threw the stone, he slung it, went straight into the forehead of Goliath, and the rest is history. Goliath fell. He quickly got on top of him, used his own sword to cut his head. If others were running away from Goliath, David was running towards Goliath. He enlisted that challenge and used it as a springboard to greater heart. Of course, you know the rest of the story. Eventually, he became king in Israel. So these are the ways we can deal with the challenges we are facing. You know, there's opportunity in adversity. This quote from Dr. B.C. Tovar, he said, there are opportunities in adversities. One of the greatest universities is the University of Adversity. There, you learn what cannot be taught in a classroom. There are opportunities in adversities. And it is in the University of Adversity that we learn critical lessons in life, which nobody will ever teach us, except we learn it from the University of Adversity. So what are we talking about? There's opportunity in adversity. We just need to see those opportunities. We just need to embrace them. We just need to use them, you know, as a springboard, you know, to something greater, you know, to something greater. You know, somebody said Sun Tzu, he said, victory comes from finding opportunities in problems. Victory comes from finding opportunities in problems. William Atterward said, adversity causes some men to break and others to break record. Adversity causes some men to break. It breaks them. But for others, they use adversity to break record. So the question is, which one do you want to do? That takes us to talking about some of the opportunities during and after COVID-19. Some investment opportunities. Number one, in telemedicine. Telemedicine will become more and more popular. Telehealth, telemedicine. You know, in other words, you know, people will be attending to people, you know, sick people remotely, doing remote diagnosis and all that. It's going to get more and more popular. It's becoming popular, the popularity will increase. It's not going to decrease. Online platforms, e-learning platforms, video conferencing platforms. I've talked about workplace collaboration tools, online media streaming, online games, live webcast is going to become more and more popular, you know, post-COVID-19. E-commerce, this is huge already. It's going to get bigger post-COVID-19. E-commerce, more than 60% of online shoppers are shopping for food, you know, especially in other parts of the world. So why? Because they can't go to a restaurant. So they have to buy food online. Somebody was telling me that in a particular state in Lagos, food delivery is becoming more and more popular. People are sitting down in their house, from the comfort of their house, they are ordering food, and it's being delivered to them. Recently, you know, a group of young people launched an app that you can, through the app, you can order for foodstuff, raw material. I mean, raw foodstuff, rather. You go to the market, buy it, and they will deliver it to you just by using an app. You see, just before the pandemic, Lagos State government, they banned Okada. They banned Okada from the road, you know, commercial motorcycle. They banned them, but they allowed those who are doing delivery services to keep operating. So there are a lot of people who are still in the delivery, service delivery business. You buy something online, they deliver it to you. That business is probably going to get bigger and bigger and more popular in Nigeria. Automation, I already talked about the shipping and logistics, you know. Amazon, when you order things on Amazon, especially during this time, if you want the delivery quicker, they will charge you 8%. They will charge you 8% and you pay more, but they get it delivered. Cyber security, I already talked about that. Internet service provider, home office furniture. For those who are into furniture business, this is something they can begin to think about. Home office furniture will become more and more popular. Why? As I said earlier, remote work will become more and more popular. So many organizations will encourage their workers, many of their workers, to be working remotely from home. As a result of that, they will be now be concerned about ergonomics. They will be concerned about preventing repetitive stress injury as a result of using the computer, you know, spending more time, you know, using the computer, working from home. So they will be thinking of, you know, maybe providing home office furniture for their workers or giving them assistance to get home office furniture. So what's going to happen? That particular branch of business is going to increase, you know, so something to start thinking about, you know, post-COVID-19. See, talking about opportunities post-COVID-19, agribusiness in Africa and all over the world is going to be huge. Why? Very simple. People need to eat. People need to eat. Farming and agribusiness value chain is huge. It's going to get bigger. Mobile payments is going to get bigger because more and more people continue to transfer money, and they are beginning, more and more people are beginning to embrace mobile payment, and their awareness is going to increase. More and more people will not want to be handling cash. If people want to be doing less of cash, it's going to become more and more popular. Digital education, online learning platform, I talk about that. Digital health, telemedicine. Some people are already going to that area in Nigeria. It's going to get more and more popular. It's going to get more and more popular. So very high quality healthcare, people who can go into that area and provide what people are going to look for abroad here, those people will probably be in business. They'll be in business. So some success stories talking about, you know, prosperity and adversity. There's a company called Clorox. They made cleaning, disinfecting products, wipes, sprays, bedroom cleaners, and so on and so forth. You know, based in the United States, in the first quarter of the year, they saw the demand for their product increase by 500%. They were doing non-stop manufacturing, yet they were not meeting the demand. Why? Because people are now more conscious because of the pandemic. They need to be more conscious about cleaning, disinfecting, and all that. You know, the sales of their cleaning products spike 32% to $671 million, according to an article in the San Francisco Chronicle. So, opportunity, prosperity in adversity. There's a company called Gilead Sciences. They created an antiviral medication called Remsidivir. The company is called Gilead Sciences. So they developed this medication to treat hepatitis C, and was also tested against the Ebola virus during the outbreak of the Ebola virus. But when the coronavirus pandemic came, they went back to this medication and they repurposed it. They repurposed it for the treatment of coronavirus. And guess what? So many countries have now, you know, endorsed it for treatment. US, India, Japan, UK, they've endorsed it for treatment. Now the demand for that product has skyrocketed. The United States government sent nearly 500,000 doses of that product, of the medication, Remsidivir, to different states over 3 weeks. You know, 500,000. So what's going to happen? That company will continue to be in business and probably continue to be more and more profitable. Albert Einstein said, in the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. In the middle of difficulty lies opportunity. There's prosperity in adversity. We need to trust God to help us to see it. Still talking about success stories. I mentioned Zoom as an online video platform. Their popularity had gone, you know, through the roof. The company was started in 2011 by a Chinese man in the US called Eric Yuan. Eric Yuan started this company, you know, in 2011. This man was born in China. He came to Silicon Valley in 1997 in the US. Before then, he made 8 failed attempts to get a visa. According to Forbes, he made 8 failed attempts to get a visa into the United States. Eventually, he got it. He worked for a company called Cisco. He was managing WebEx, you know, one of their tools. And then he left them to go and start his own in 2011. Fast forward 2020. Because of the outbreak of the pandemic, Zoom became, their popularity went through the roof. The value of the company is now $50 billion. over 90,000 schools across 20 countries are using their video conferencing services to conduct classes remotely. So governments are using them to do a meeting. In the Federal Executive Council meeting in Nigeria, they are now doing it online. So many countries are using Zoom. So many, you know, government agencies are using Zoom. Individual schools are using that platform. Their popularity has gone up. The net worth of Eric Yuan is now $9.3 billion as of June 5th, 2020. $9.3 billion. Prosperity in adversity. Opportunity in difficulty. May God open our eyes to see. May God give us divine ideas, divine insight, divine inspiration. We can go on and on and on, but time will not permit us to talk about Netflix, talk about Amazon. I was reading the report of first quarter report, financial report of MTN Nigeria. MTN Nigeria, first quarter profit grew 5.8% to 51 billion naira. 51 billion naira. Opportunity in adversity. Because people are staying at home, more and more people are now using data services, internet services. More and more people make calls. Their profit went up. First quarter profit grew 5.8% to 51 billion naira from 48 billion naira for the same period back in 2019, comparatively. There's prosperity in adversity. Time will not permit us to talk about others. But as I begin to wrap up, let's talk about principles for turnaround and sustainability. We need to be grateful. Be grateful to God for where you are and for where He's taking you. Why? Because God has a plan for our lives. His thoughts to us are of peace and not of evil, to give us a future and a hope, to bring us to an expected end. Jeremiah 29 verse 11, that's a popular scripture. God has a plan for us. We need to be grateful. We need to be optimistic. We need to be see the glass as half full, not as half empty. Be optimistic. Be proactive. All these things we're talking about, pray that God will help you to take action on them. Get ready. Prepare yourself. Be proactive. Recognize and seize open doors when you see them. Recognize. I think it was Thomas Edison who said, I will prepare and I will wait and the opportunity will come. And then if you are down because of coronavirus, believe that you can rise up again. Believe that you will rise up again. Because God is going to restore all the years that the locusts and the cancans and the palmers and the caterpillars have eaten. God said He will restore them. Joel chapter 2. Above all, we need to change our thinking. Proverbs 23:7. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. We need to change our thinking. Change your thinking, change your life. I'm trying to wrap this up, but I just want to share this. You know, I have the opportunity of being in Cape Town, South Africa, some years ago. Myself and three other people from work, we went on an official trip for a training program. When we landed in Cape Town, somebody was arranged to pick us from the airport. He picked us from the airport and he was taking us to the hotel where we're going to stay. Along the way, he was showing us different places and different landmarks, you know, in Cape Town. And then we got to a particular place and he showed us, said, look at that place. And in that place, we saw some modern, low-cost, you know, buildings. And he said, that place we are looking at used to be like a slum, shanties. And government came and told the people living in the slum that, look, we want to make your life better. We want to build modern buildings for you so that you stop living in this slum and in these shanties. So, you know what they told the government? They said, well, we appreciate that you want to build modern building for us. But this is what we want you to do for us. We want you to move our slum, our shanties to the back, and whatever you want to build them in front. Government said, if that's what you want, fine, no problem. So they went ahead and built, you know, moved their shanties to the back, and they built modern, low-cost, you know, houses for them. And they handed them the keys. Guess what happened? After they handed them the keys, they rented out the modern buildings and they remained in their shanties and in their slum at the back. And they rented out the modern building. So the man who picked up from the airport was telling us that, can we see now that the problem of the people is their thinking? So we need to change our thinking. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. We need to change our thinking. so that we can change our lives. We need to change our outlook. We need to change our perspectives post-COVID-19. And principles for turnaround and sustainability, we need to keep our eyes on the Lord. Keep your eyes on God. Keep your eyes on God. It will never fail. It will never disappoint. It will come through for us. Don't lose your faith. Don't lose hope. Stay positive. Like I said, stay optimistic. Watch your attitude and your confession. Watch your confession. What comes out of your mouth. The power of life and death reside in the tongue. Say good things about yourself. Prophesy good things into your life, into your family, into your household, into the life of your children, your spouse. Don't allow anger, frustration, or depression. Don't allow suicidal thoughts, because the future is brighter. Greater things are going to come. Better things are going to spring up after COVID-19. So don't lose out. Be careful on the home front. Keep your home together. And very important, don't stay away from the church. Maintain spiritual networking. Very important. Maintain spiritual networking. Don't run away from God. Don't stay away from the Lord. And very important, pray for divine idea, divine inspiration. I'm praying for that. I'm encouraging us to be praying for divine idea, divine insight, divine inspiration. If you go back to the story of Jacob in the house of Laban, Jacob would have died in poverty in the house of Laban. The man was just playing him and deceiving him, changing his salary all the time. If not for God's intervention in the life of Jacob, God gave him divine revelation, divine inspiration on genetic engineering and gave him a business idea. He started doing genetic engineering and manipulating the genes of the animals through divine revelation. And God gave him divine business idea. He made a deal with Laban. The rest is history. That was the beginning of his prosperity. He would have died a poor man. He would have died a pauper in the house of Laban as a servant. If not for divine revelation, divine inspiration, divine insight. So finally, let me use these scriptures to encourage us. Isaiah 40:31, the Bible says, those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. Trust in the Lord. God is going to come through for us. Job 22:29 says, when men are cast down, we will say there's a lifting. Post-COVID-19, when people are complaining and saying there's a casting down, we will say there's a lifting. God is going to lift us up. As I mentioned earlier, Joel chapter 2, verses 25 to 27, God promised restoration. So he's going to restore all the years that the locusts and the cankerworms and the palmerworms and the caterpillars have eaten. God said he will restore them. God said he's going to restore them. So let's hold on to the word of God. In Isaiah chapter 49, verses 14 to 16, Isaiah 49, 14 to 16, God said that he has not forsaken us. He has not forgotten us. He has engraved us upon the palms of his hand. He said our words are continually before him. God has not forgotten us. God has not forsaken us. God has not forgotten us. He will come through for us. He has not forsaken us. He has not forgotten us. He will come through for us. He will come through for us. God has not forsaken us. God said he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. He said, can a woman forget a child that is sucking? That we should have the compassion on the son of our womb. He said, even if they forget, they will not forget us. Say, he has engraved you. Another translation says, he has inscribed you on the palm of his hands. He said, your words are continually before him. Another translation says, God has tattooed us. You know, permanent tattoo. God has tattooed us on the palm of his hands. He said, our words are continually, our lives are. We feel his thoughts. He will never forget us. He will never forsake us. He will never leave us. So let's trust God. Let's put our trust in him. Let's believe him for divine idea, divine inspiration, so that post-COVID-19, we will not experience a casting down. We will experience a lifting up to the glory of God. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Please let us pray. Father, we thank you. We appreciate you. We bless your holy name. We give you glory, honor, and adoration. Thank you, Father, for the time we have spent together and for the discussion we have had. Thank you for the insights, ideas, illumination, revelation that you have given unto us. Father, we pray that, Lord, you will help us. Help us, Father, as we think about these things, as we meditate on these things. Please, Lord, help us that you will elaborate them in our heart and our mind. You will enlarge our heart to be able to receive that which you have for us and give us the grace to be able to take action, to be able to take action on them, oh God. Thank you, Father, because you make all grace abundant. You make God all grace available unto us. And you will help us to the glory of your holy name. Thank you, everlasting Father. Blessed be your name. Take all the glory, honor, and adoration. Be exalted, O God. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thank you. God bless you.
Wow. I'm sure you've learned a lot these past weeks from all the teachings. Join us again next week as we conclude this very session with Mr. Seun Olatoye. Feel free to drop your questions and comments in the comment section below. See you next week. Remain blessed in God's arms.